Okay. Today is lesson number 4, finite element method in engineering. We are going to talk about beam elements and bar elements, one-dimensional elements. And you will see that everything comes together. Mechanics of materials, everything you have learned about the formations, and also about beam theory is included in these elements that are widely used and are very, very good to solve structures. Okay? When we talk about these elements and we say one-dimensional, you may imagine just one wire, one line. But in fact, we can represent cross-sections like these ones, whatever section, and it's defined between two points, that is at the centroid of these elements of the cross-section. If you remember, probably from mechanics of materials, what is so particular about the centroid when the thing deforms as a beam? What happens there? Is there deformation in the centroid? How is it called? It is called the neutral axis. Okay? That's why it's so important. So when we are modeling things in finite elements, and we define two nodes, and we put a 1D element, we might have it like this. But there are some tricks there that we need to consider. Sorry, I'm taking a marker. When we define an element like this, because in fact it could be all rotated, still between the two points and still at the centroid. So in some elements, especially beams, we need to define some sort of normal. It's a unit vector defining in which sense the element is. Because it could be like this, this beam. There could be the same one, but instead of going from here to here, like that, will be completely in the other sense. You know what I mean? The same line, but instead of being like that, the eye is like this. Okay. That's why we need this normal, especially in 3D. When we are dealing with 1D elements in a three-dimensional space, we need to define that normal to identify the major axes of these elements. Okay? We have usually channels or these kind of shapes. Obviously, the I beam, symmetric or non-symmetric, T beam, L beam, and the C. Okay? Also, we have pipes, circular or rectangular pipes, hollow section, circular hollow section, rectangular hollow section, solid rectangular section, solid circular section. There is no limit to have any cross section behaving as a beam. Okay? There are also cable elements and spring elements as one dimensional elements. Okay? Depending on the package you use, it usually will allow you to define whatever section. Okay? And even if it's a very simple software, like the one I'm going to give you, you define this cross-section with the inertia moments. Okay? You learn how to calculate inertia moments. You know that there are two major inertia moments for these kind of sections, for bending. And with those, you are telling the program how stiff, how good the element is. Okay? To solve problems, probably like this. This is a bridge, probably very old bridge, designed by hand. Now it's analyzed here in a finite element code. And you can see the colors probably is the force or the in this case I think it's the force, or probably the stress in each element. The engineers that designed this, probably they didn't have electronic calculators. But you learn also in statics the method of joints, you remember? And method of sections. It's a truss, these are. And obviously this is hanging, can be just represented as loads here. And this is the main thing for the bridge, for the cars, for the train, whatever these things. But now we are able to solve this numerically and have this nice simulations with colors indicating displacements, forces, stresses in the elements. Okay? I like bridges. It's very representative for the use of 1D elements. In the case of the car or automotive industry, you can simulate buses or the box of a truck carrying merchandise, and it's even simpler than these geometries. Okay, it's just rectangular product. But I tell you, many of the bridges were built, like these ones, long before computers. Now, people are optimizing and doing many other things. Now I have here a model for the automotive industry. And you all probably are involved in some sort of student chapter for formula student or whatever it is called, PSI. And then you have go-karts like these ones. And the chassis is all made with pipes connected, forming a structure. And these are 1D elements. This image comes from a master's thesis in Cranfield University. If any of you want to do a master's, there are many universities, especially in the UK, where you can do automotive engineering simulations and also applications. And this is part of the master's thesis. Simulation, the crash analysis of this small go-kart. Okay? Okay. But before we proceed to the linear elements, let's talk a little bit about analysis. Okay? Probably 99% of structures that we deal in real life, as you call it, are designed assuming linear static behavior of the material. And that includes some assumptions that we must repeat here. Small deformations. The loading pattern is not changed due to the deformed shape. I mean, the deformations are not large enough to consider a nonlinear analysis. Materials are elastic. The stress level does not go above the yield value. The static loads, the load is applied to the structure in a slow or steady fashion. We can all see the difference between a static and dynamic load when we talk about our beds. When we were kids, our parents said, don't jump on the beds. You remember that? And you could break it. But they say, why the bed doesn't break when two adults are sleeping on the bed, but it could break with a kid jumping on the bed? It's the difference of load. When you go on the bed, you deposit yourself slowly as an adult. If you have a kid jumping, this kind of dynamic effect might make the deformations large enough to break the structure of the bed. Okay. So these are three assumptions that structural analysis that are considered linear are including. A linear static analysis is probably the first solution to most problems. Unless you are dealing with crash, like in the previous slide. When it's crash, then you need to talk about dynamic analysis. And probably involves several or thousands of solutions of linear analysis to simulate the time of a crash. Okay. But for most of our analysis, let's consider that we are into linear static analysis. Now, oops.
Sorry.
There's a yawning here. You might hear it in the video. This is a bar element. We go back to mechanics of materials one. We are defined by two nodes. And there are two things defining this element. The area, that's the cross section, and the Young modulus, okay? And then you remember from mechanics of materials one, what was the formula for a deformation of a bar element? You remember?
Yeah.
Force times the length divided by
EA.
Okay? This was the change in length. Knowing the internal force applied to a bar, knowing the length, and knowing the elastic modulus and the area, And EA was called even from the axial rigidity or stiffness. Okay. This product is important. It tells us how good, because it could be steel, it could be aluminum, it could be copper, whatever. The value of E changes for each material, and the cross section can also change. So there are two ways to increase the rigidity: increasing the E, putting a better material, or A, the cross section. Okay. So we have a bar, two nodes, I and J. Nodal force Fi here, nodal force Fj here. Displacements Ui here. And this is the bar element. Truss element. Okay. Truss as armadura in Spanish. Okay. Now let us see more definitions about this element. Well, this is the explanation. You remember also Hooke's law in 1D. Stress is equal to the young modulus times the unit strain. And we had this strain displacement relationship. The change displacement along X is the unit strain. Okay? So this is the formula. But. What about the material? How does it behave? If we are talking about steel, we have some sort of graph like this that comes from the lab. You put a bar in tension, and you may recover this kind of graph. And when we talk about linear behavior, this is epsilon, this is sigma. When we are talking about the linear region, or linear behavior, the material is here. The stress level does not go above this proportional limit, or shear stress. It's here. If it goes above, then we will have permanent deformation, and that's something that we need to take into account in a nonlinear analysis. But for our analysis, we will consider we are here. Okay. Now, this is the direct method to get to the stiffness matrix. This is the derivation, and we have something here called a displacement along the bar is given by these values multiplied by the nodal displacements. Okay? This is called a function defining the displacement at any position x along the bar. So we also have this by definition, the change in length divided by L gives us the unit strain, and by Hooke's law we get this. Okay? This is just a way to put the formulas we already know from mechanics of materials 1. We also know the definition of stress is force divided by area. We substitute this in the previous equation, we get this. Force is equal to something multiplied by the change in length or displacement. And if you remember, what is this? K times delta. We talked about this before. In the previous element, it's called the spring.
Constant.
Yes, K was the spring constant, delta the displacement. So this is like the force in a spring, analogous to force in a spring that you learn in high school. Okay? So we can say that K is equal to A times A divided by L. And we call this the stiffness of the bar. This is the bar element in 1D. The bar is acting like a spring, and therefore the stiffness for an element, bar element, can be written in a matrix form like this, where K is now A times A divided by L. Assuming linear static, linear behavior of the material, the bar element, the one that you learn in mechanics of material 1, in axial loading, is behaving like a spring. Well, this is the value of the spring constant. Okay? So we can put this thing out, and then the stiffness matrix for one bar element is this. AA divided by L multiply matrix 1, minus 1, minus 1, 1. Okay? So the element equilibrium equation is just like this. This is very analogous to what we just did with springs. Okay? But now, the K is calculated with this. Any questions so far? No? Okay, this is the third week of your summer course, and you're already dead, because this is a 7 a.m. class. I'm going to be 48 years of age by August. How old are you? Who's the oldest here? Who's 22? 21? Most of you. 20? You? 23? Your age? 24?
24.
Okay. I doubled your age. I'm almost 48. Am I not falling asleep? Okay? So.
It is because we are not drinking coffee.
It's just the second sip of my coffee. It's Nescafe, no es café. In Spanish, it's a joke. Okay. Yes, but you need to go to bed early. I went to bed at 10 p.m. last night to be able to be here. Okay. Now, degree of freedom, what is that? It's the number of components of the displacement vector at a node. So, if we are in three dimensions, at a certain node, we may have up to 6 displacements. 3 linear displacements and 3 rotations. But when we are talking about the one-dimensional element, we only have 1 degree of freedom at each node. Okay? That is one. DOF is called degree of freedom. It's like an acronym. What is the meaning of the coefficients in K, the stiffness matrix for this element? The jth column of K, here J is equal to 1 or 2, represents the forces applied to the bar to maintain a deformed shape with union displacements at node J and zero displacement at the other node. Okay? I know that it's difficult at this time of the day. This is a formal approach, and you may use something called shape functions. And I'm not going to bother you because you could take a full course, semester course, in a postgraduate school for finite elements, because this is a nicer mathematical way of expressing the same. But now using something called natural coordinates, Z, and they vary from 0 to 1 only, where Z is this change of variable here. So the function that before it was a bit more complicated now can be just expressed like this, 1 minus C and at the node J, C. And they can be written as this, but this is the formal approach of finite elements. And then you get displacements like this, shape functions multiplying the nodal displacement, and can be expressed like this, where N is a matrix of shape functions. U is the displacement vector, and also epsilon, or the unit strain, can be expressed as the derivative with respect to x of n times the displacement vector. And this is called the matrix V, okay? The strain displacement matrix. And all this is just mathematics there, very simple mathematics, but using the natural coordinates. And we get to this. And this is the formula. We have this, substitute the value of epsilon like this. We get to the strain energy story in a bar. This is a standard formula. We will see it later for other cases as well. And we get to this. And not to bother you too much with mathematics, we get, if we use a conservative system, the internal energy is equal to the work done by those external forces we get to this, more mathematics, and this is again k times u equals f. Okay? So this is the definition of any stiffness matrix in finite elements. The integral along the volume of this matrix B, that you know that is the strain displacement relationship, times E, that in the case of 1D is not a matrix, along the volume times the displacement equal F. Okay. And I tell you, this formula can be applied to any finite element of any dimension. This is the formal procedure to get to the stiffness matrix using the principle of minimum potential energy. And we can give us again the formula for the element matrix. And there's another method as well called the Galerkin method. Who has taken this course before? Just for information. Who's repeating the course? No?
Not yet.
Not yet? Your friend, I think. No? You?
No.
No? Why? The other teacher who came here for the first three lectures told me that all of you were already second time taking the course. He didn't get it? No? This is the first time you take the course? First time?
There are just like three people that already take the course.
Yeah? You already took this course?
Yes, we
did. When you learned about finite elements in the previous course?
We didn't take anything about...
No? Well, it's an important part of the program.
All the course was about the old beams and that stuff, but I don't remember anything about...
Good! Okay, so this is new for you.
Yes.
Okay, don't worry. Now, I should make an... announcement or state this. The first time I learned about this, with this notation, I was studying my master's. It was also a 7 o'clock a.m. lecture in Monterrey in August in 1994. I don't remember, but I remember that 7 a.m. the temperature was like 37 degrees Celsius. And there was no air conditioning in the lecture rooms, Campus Monterrey at that time. So it was like hell. And we were like sleeping, not even understanding this. And believe me, it's still a complicated thing to explain it and to motivate it. But I tell you, you can take the course 2 times in a master's, at a master's level, and then you may get it. Okay, so don't worry too much. Just remember that all this derivation to get to the stiffness matrix that is very simple, this AAL times 1 and 1 and 1, 1, comes from conservation principles of energy. Energy stored in the material assuming linear behavior, linear elastic behavior of the material, equivalent to the external work done by forces. Depending on the procedure you get, but you will always get to this for the bar element, the stiffness matrix. And we're interested in the stiffness matrix because at the end, we are solving something like this for a full structure, Ku equals F, okay? And we need to assemble a global stiffness matrix using a small case that are assembled into the global one. But to get to this expression, you use the formula now. K equals AA divided by L1 and 1 and 1, 1. You will not have any problem. And we are going to see now an example. If you want to get deeper into the derivation of this, then, as I mentioned at the very beginning, of lecture 1 of this course, a very brief course, introductory course for finite element, you should go and take a master's on this. There are many places where you can study masters. But as engineers, I'm sure you are willing to go already into software to solve problems. Okay? But we need to see, at least for 1D elements, where the stiffness matrix comes from. Okay? Now, first example. You remember these kind of problems in mechanics of materials? It was a statically indeterminate problem. And you had to solve it. And probably it was a nightmare for you in the final exam of that course. Because this cannot be solved by statics. We have one reaction here, and one equilibrium equation that can be used. It's only the sum of forces in X. You agree?
Yeah.
One equilibrium equation, two reactions, this problem is statically indeterminate problem. So the way I teach this, and you can go into the channel and see in Spanish, even a playlist of videos solving statically indeterminate problems for axial loading, then you will see that the procedure is equilibrium equation, geometry of deformation equation or compatibility equation, third step, force displacement relationships, then doing some algebra and solving for the unknowns that are the reaction. But that was the procedure in mechanics of material. Now we're going to do finite element or matrix analysis to solve this problem. Okay? We are going to use two 1D bar elements. So one element going from here to here, another one from here to here. We have two sections, two cross sections. The first one is got an area of 2A, the second one is got an area of A. They are made from the same material E and E. And there's an external force applied in the middle in the connection with a magnitude of P. Sorry, there are no numbers for P, A, and E, but doesn't matter. It's a very simple problem, we'll solve it now. For the first, where's the element one? Matrix. It's here. So we have, the general formula is E times A, but the A for this element is 2A. Divided by L, 1 minus 1 minus 1, 1. And it goes from node 1 to node 2. This is good to know. Then for element 2, it goes from node 2 to node 3, or degree freedom 2, degree freedom 3. L is only one area in this element. And then we assemble this into the global stiffness matrix. This part is for element 1, but it overlaps with element 2 here. So we have a 2 here plus 1 from here gets 3. And then we have the degrees of freedom U1, U2, U3, F1, F2, and F3. This one is reaction, and this is going to be the external force P. Okay. Now, what was the next step to solve this problem? Boundary conditions, you remember from springs. So what are the boundary conditions here? Displacement 1 and displacement 3 equal 0. Okay. It's here. External force at node 2 is equal to P. So if these are equal to 0, I can get rid of the first row and the first column, and then the third row and the third column. And I get to what? Only this equation. 3AL times U2 equals P. This is the reduced system. Therefore, U2 is equal to what? Immediately. So this is called reduced system from here. And it's this. Immediately we get a solution. The problem is already solved, just like that, without inverting a matrix, because it's very simple. Okay. Now what? We need to find the reaction forces from this global equation. We already know U2. Force 1 is equal to this times 0, this times this, and this times 0. Then force 3 is 0 times 0, minus 1 times U2, 1 times 0. And then we get already the reactions in just two steps. Okay? U1 0, U2. Okay. The stress applying the general formula is equal to this. E times this. But this B is already known by this because it's the derivative of the shape functions respect to X. minus 1 divided by L, 1 divided by L. So we do that U1, U2, whatever. We get to this. This is the stress in the first element. Just using this solution of the displacements. The same for element 2. We just substitute the nodes, U2 and U3, and we get to the stress in the element 2. And there's a negative sign indicating that the element is in compression. Okay? And the problem is solved as far as that. Well, there's also the reactions that we can calculate here from the global equation. So F1, we can do it here. 2 times 0. Obviously, all this is multiplied by EL. EAL. Then minus 2. Minus 2 times, what is the value of U2?
3.
Well, we leave it like U2. And then 0 times 0. Then U2 here was equal to P times L divided by 3A. So therefore, F1, the reaction 1 is minus 2 times PL times 3AA times EAL. We cancel L, AAAA, and we get what?
2P there.
There we go, that's the reaction 1. And reaction 3, minus 2 times 0, but we have this AA. The 0 times 0, minus 1, U2, PL, 3AA, and 1 times 0. Therefore, what do we get? Like this. The sum is minus P. F3 plus F1. And that's fine, because they should balance the external force P. Okay? So the system is in equilibrium. It's always a good check to see the sum of reactions plus the sum of external forces equals 0. And that's the case. Because this is the sum of the reactions, but the external force P equals 0. Okay? System is in equilibrium. Good. Now, let's see what's next. We had already seen this and this. Some notes now before we advance to consider and remember. The stresses in this kind of element, 1 and 2, are exact within the linear theory of 1D bar structures. It doesn't need to be divided into more elements, okay? You remember my first analogy with Legos? And you know that in Legos, the smaller the pieces, the more real the model looks like. And in finite elements, as a very gross prescription or advice, the more elements you put, the better the solution. In a general case, but that's something gross, it's not elegant. But you're engineers, you are not just technicians about the computer. So you know where to put more elements, it's not just like putting more. Now you have very powerful computers, very powerful, believe me, compared to the first ones. Even an iPhone, it's got a processor that is 64 bits or whatever, it's very powerful, this thing. It's much more powerful than the computer that took the man to the moon. But you don't know about these problems. But even when I was doing my PhD around the year 2000, computer memory and time for the solution was also a problem. The RAM was limited. Still, the RAM is limited. And you don't suffer it with scientific applications. You suffer it when you run many applications in your computer. What is the standard now to not to have problems with Windows in RAM? What is the size of RAM you need to have a good performance of your computer? 8 gigabytes, probably 16 or 32 if you want to do some proper gaming and graphics. Okay, so that's why you don't know about these things. But in a very complicated model, when we are talking about already like tens of thousands of elements, instead of having 10,000 elements, probably to have just 5,000 or 1,000 makes a difference. So the good thing for you is that one line, just one bar element can represent properly the behavior of the structure. You don't need more. Okay? For taper bars, what is a taper bar? Sección variable. Something like this. Imagine you have something like this, representing a bar. I don't know if you learned about this in Mechanics of Materials 1, in which you had even integrals to solve for the deformations when the variable section was like this. But the good thing about finite elements is that we don't need. We can approximate it several ways, and some assume that we could use even an average value of the cross section. In this case, an average value of area. Area average. That's a good engineering approach. Another ones will suggest that you use several elements and then you include the proper area that you are having at that time for each section. As you have seen, we needed to find the displacements first in order to find the stresses, because this is an approach called displacement-based finite element method. Okay? Most of the structural analysis that you will use, we are finding displacements, okay, at the nodes. And from there we get strains, and then from strains we get stresses. Okay? It's a very simple element. Let's solve another problem, a bit more complicated maybe. Now we have this. We have a gap, and we have two bars, and we apply a force P, and we want to know if this thing will eventually touch, and when it touches, it becomes what? No, it becomes a statically indeterminate problem, because this will act like a support. This is a tricky problem that professors in Mechanics of Materials 1, they introduce in exams. So probably they put you this gap, but if the gap is big enough, then you get what? You first need to check if this force P is going to cause this section to deform, because this will just move like that. But this thing will deform from here to here a certain distance when we apply the force P. And we need to find that deformation if it's greater than this gap. If it is not, it means that the bar will never touch this, and then the problem is finished, statically determined problem, and that's it. But usually it touches, and when it touches, it becomes a mess. Okay? We have it here, 1.2 millimeters. These are the values, now we have numbers. Let's solve it using the finite element method. Okay? Solution. This is what I told you. We need first to check if or not the contact of the bar with the wall on the right will occur. To do this, we use the first section and the force, the value of the force, L and A, E and A, and we get 1.8 millimeters, which is greater than 1.2 of the gap. Contact will occur. Then we need to find the global finite element solution. We already had a matrix for the previous problem, but let's see what is this. What do you see as different? It's the same, see it? We use half constant cross section, that's why AAL. Here is one from one bar, and one from the other bar gives two. This is the global finite element equation. What are the boundary conditions? At node 2, we have an external force of 6.0 times 10 to the 4 newtons. Displacement 1 equals 0, but displacement 3 equals this. Is already set to the gap. So how this is different to the other one? We cannot just remove this and this because it's not zero here. So we do a different static reduction of the matrix. What is this? Sorry. There we are. Okay. Now what is the second equation? Let's see. AL 2 minus 1. Yes, we do that. We just remove this and this, and we end up with this. We can solve knowing the value of delta is a constant for U2. And we get to this. Solving for this, we get this. And substituting the data, we get that U2 equals 1.5 millimeters, when U3 is equal to 1.2, U1 is equal to 0. Okay. Tan, tan, tan. We got all the displacements. Now we can find the stresses in the bar. Support reaction forces we need to apply from the global finite element equation. You know how we do that? We go back to the equation here. Oops, too fast. F1 equals to this times this, this times this, and this times this. Okay. And the same for F3. 1 minus 1, 0. We get this. The third equation is, but we have U3 equals to the delta. We get this and this. And these are the reaction forces. Okay. We could even find the forces in the elements, but it was not required by the problem. Just determine the support reactions was the question. But you see how simple it is to solve this using finite elements instead of following the procedure. Longer procedure, but it's implicit here from mechanics of materials one. Any questions? Tom? Okay, let me see. Yeah. The review system is like that. Then we get P plus P plus. Yeah. Directly from the equation 2 we can get the value of U2. Okay. What happens when there's a distributed loading? These things change. We need to do those now something else, but let me include it here, and then we finish the video. When there's distributed loading, we need to approximate it as nodal loads. And one approach is to see the consistent or concentrated loading to the nodes, Q times L divided by 2. Okay. Half the load, the total load in L, is at each node. This is one way of doing it. For higher order elements or different elements for two dimensions or three dimensions, these coefficients might not be just half. We might have even nodes in the middle. Okay? But there are certain functions defining that. But this is a way of doing it. It's called the consistent loading. And this is a mathematical way of doing it. This is the work done by the load. Using the natural coordinates I introduced before. And then the conservative system using the internal energy stored in the other, to make one's external work, blah, blah, blah. We get to this. And we get to the force vector with distributed load and QL divided by 2, QL divided by 2. Okay. Now, when we have three nodes, we might get something different. Okay. It's a different element with three nodes instead of one. Okay, this is an assembly of two bars. We have QL divided by 2, QL divided by 2, but QL divided by 2 of the second element gives me QL, QL divided by 2. Okay, this is for the next. But let me see how we are in time. Yes, we have time to finish this. What happens when the bar is not just horizontal? When we have a global system, X uppercase, Y uppercase, and this is the local system. So far we have derived the equations for local system on the bar. But what happens when these two don't coincide? We need to map these into the global different coordinate system. Now when we are in local, we have only 1 degree of freedom, displacement in that direction, displacement in that direction. But here, this displacement will have two components. So therefore, in the global one, we have 2 degrees of freedom per node. And then we do need to do something called transformation of this element into the global system in order to assemble a global stiffness matrix. And that is done with a very simple procedure using the cosines and sines of the bars. And then we get the projection of the displacement in a new system using these cosines and sines. Then we represent the cosine with L, the sine with M. And we get now to the stiffness matrix. Well, first, how is the transformation done? With a matrix operation. If you have a vector that you need to transform into a new system, you just apply this transformation matrix that is this, in this case of 2D. That is orthogonal, that is the inverse of this matrix is equal to the transpose of this matrix. And applying this, we get now the two nodes of the bar, like two different degrees of freedom per node. This is the node I, and this is the node J. And we have two and two. One in U, this is X uppercase, is global. So we will have one displacement U and one displacement V for each node. This is node I and node J. So the matrix that was very small for a bar element, now we'll have a larger matrix. Okay? Using this transformation equation, also the nodal forces transform the same way, we end up with this matrix for the 2D space like this. Okay. But this is the using the prime displacements, which involves a certain transformation before. Using the transformations, a lot of matrix algebra there, we get to this. This is finally the equation you need to use in Excel when we solve problems. And you see this AL, A times A divided by L, instead of having 1, 1, minus 1, 1, 1 minus 1, minus 1, 1. But now we have this, and this for node I, and for node J, two displacements in U and in the vertical. In U, horizontal, and in the vertical. And this is just one bar element, the matrix, where L is this and M is this. Okay? But the element is still one dimensional, but we are mapping it into a two dimensional space. Okay? So what is the application of this? Also, the element stresses are given by this. For instance, this problem. Now we have inclined elements. We know that in the local system, we have the matrices like this. AA divided by L, 1 minus 1 minus 1, 1. But now we need to map it into the global system. So for element 1, theta is equal to 45 degrees with respect to the global one. Therefore, L equals M equals this value that we know from high school. So K of element 1 is this, already mapped into the global system like this. U1, V1, U2, V2. We do the same for element 2. Now theta equals 135. Why? Because we need to take also the first node, I, of element 2, and measure the angle, 135. Okay. We get this matrix in the global system, and now we need to overlap or map these two into the finite element equation in the global system. You see that overlapping occurs here. And now we have node 1, node 2, node 3, 2 degrees of freedom per node. And we have external forces in X or Y in the global system. Okay? This is the finite element equation without reduction. But now we need to see what is happening to the supports, the boundary condition. You cannot move in X or Y, here node 1, and also in 3, you cannot move in X and Y. These are the constraints, boundary conditions. So we need to apply it here. This is it. U1 equals V1 equals U3 V3. So the reduced system, by canceling all these, we get to this. Two unknowns, U2 and V2. We need to know P1 and P2. Substituting the values, we get this. This system of equations with two unknowns, U2 and V2. By knowing these displacements, we can find the stresses using the formulas presented before in the bar 1 and in the bar 2. And we need to check the results that these things are in equilibrium and so on. Okay. So this is an application. We can also use inclined supports and things like that. For instance, this problem. This is called multi-point constraint because it's an inclined support. Okay? Now we have another system here. Some packages allow you this, to have an inclined support. Determine the displacements and reaction forces. This is the area for elements 1 and 2, area for element 3, and L is equal to 1 meter. Obviously, this is called a different length. And this is the angle and so on. Okay, let's see how they solve it. Element 1, theta 90 degrees, L is equal 0, M equal 1, because it's a horizontal bar. K1 in the global system is this. For element 2 is 0. So the previous one was 90, right? So it was vertical. This is the horizontal one, the element 2. We get this in the global system, and then for element 3, theta 45, and these are the sine and cosine. Cosine and sine, so we get this in the global system. We assemble the global stiffness matrix like this. Or finite element equation, because we have also the vectors and external forces. Boundary conditions, U1 equals V1 equals V2 equals 0. And this thing that is inclined, V3 is there, equals 0 in the local system for the support. And these are the external forces. Only in the x direction we have P at node 3. So we need to deal with the transformation of node free the, this direction using the transformation equation. So it's mapped like this, and we need to recover this. This is another equation that needs to be included into the global finite element equation, U3 minus V3 equals 0. It's called a multipoint constraint. Also, for the force in the local direction at node 3 is this, you get that, and solving this with the global boundary conditions in the global finite element equation, we get this to this reduced system. We already know from this. From the multipoint constraint, we also can include it here, and also the forces. A lot of algebra here, but it can be systematically introduced into finite element code that you don't see how, but you just say, I want to have a support in this direction, and what it's doing is this, doing transformation of degrees of freedom, transformation of forces to solve it, and what you get is just the result of the reaction in that direction. And this is it, the solution. And solving first the part of the forces, you get them to solve the displacement, and you get to this, to calculate the reactions. Okay? And that's shown here. Well, you can check this in more detail, but don't worry, since this is a very, this is just an introductory part of the finite element course. In this course of advanced strengths of materials, I'm not going to ask you in an exam an inclined support because it's long. Okay. And this is a global equation for multipoint constraints. In Astra, you just only need to specify this relationship to the software, and the software will take care of the solution because it's got a very good solver. The package I'm going to pass you does not include multipoint constraints, but is housemate for these courses, finite element. Analysis of beam and trusses in 2D. Okay. Next lecture we'll talk about the beam element. So far, let us do now some exercise about the bar element. Okay. I'll see you in lecture 5. This was lecture 4, bar element in finite elements, a brief introduction. See you.